from Brussels Convention, and I've been in Almaty 5 years ago for the 10-year anniversary of the SBS Naval, and I would like to congratulate Dr. Savinov Sergei for the 15th anniversary of his group, who is doing a huge job in clinical neurophysiology in Kazakhstan. So Belgium is a very small country located between France, UK, United Kingdom, Germany and the Netherlands. We are famous mainly for beers and chocolates, and we are also famous because our hospital is the only one in Belgium to have an EEG system for a country that has about 10 million people. So magnetoencephalography is linked to electroencephalography. In magnetoencephalography, you can isolate the term magnetic, which means that this technology will allow you to non-invasively record the magnetic fields generated by the electrical activity of the brain. And as you know, the EEG or the electroencephalography will allow you to have access to the recordings of the electrical activity of the brain. The main difference between EEG and MEG is that MEG mainly records the variation of the visceral cortical activity, so the cortical activity which is located in the sulcus of the brain, and you have access with MEG to about two-thirds of the activity of the cortical surface. So MEG has a higher sensitivity to the cortical activity in the sulci than EEG for some parts of the brain, and I will show you some examples. So this means that with MEG you can detect EEG activity, you can detect neuronal activity that EEG does not, and vice versa. So this is an important message because a lot of scientists or neurologists or epileptologists consider that MEG and EEG will provide you the same type of information, but actually this is not the case. MEG and EEG are and should be viewed as complementary techniques, meaning that you cannot have access to the whole information that you will get when you will use both techniques if you only use MEG or EEG. One of the main interesting aspects of MEG is that it can be used to estimate the electrical brain sources generating the recorded magnetic field. So basically, with MEG, you will record the magnetic field outside the head, and what you would like to have as information is what is the brain source that has generated this magnetic field outside the skull. So to do that, you have to co-register MEG and structural MRI in the same 3D space using various source reconstruction approaches, and you can achieve what we call magnetic source imaging. You can do exactly the same with EEG and do electrical source imaging. But as you can see on this slide, MEG has a better spatial resolution than EEG. The spatial resolution of MEG is about a few millimeters. And the other important aspect of MEG, like EEG compared to fMRI and PET, is that, as you know, it gives you access to a very high temporal resolution at the level of the millisecond, so that you can track the brain activity in time. Why MEG has a better spatial resolution than EEG? Because it typically uses much more sensor than EEG, more than 300 in most of the modern MEG system. The MEG signal provides you better signal-to-noise ratio than EEG, and also because the magnetic fields are much less sensitive to conductivity, inhomogeneities, and anisotropy, which means that it's easier to locate the sources in the brain that have generated the MEG signal. The MEG signal look pretty much like an EEG, except that you have more than 300 sensors, so it's difficult to look on one screen on those 300 lines of signal and rhythmic activity of the brain, so we typically use butterfly plots where we group the signals of the different sensors from different brain regions. As you can see here, this is 5 seconds of MEG signal, and you can directly see here that there is a epileptic discharge, an interictal epileptic discharge located over the bilateral frontotemporal regions. And you can use this signal to localize the brain areas that have generated this MEG signal. And using the high temporal resolution of MEG and the good spatial resolution of this technique, you can localize the onset and the peak of this discharge at the left inferior frontal gyrus with rapid propagation in about 10 to 15 milliseconds over the left hemisphere. As the EEG signal, the MEG signal is complex, you have access to time, so the temporal aspects of the brain activity. With this high temporal resolution, you can have aspect to the spectral, meaning the different frequencies of the brain activity, and you also have access to the spatial dynamics of brain activity. When you record the MEG or the EEG signal, you typically have access to sensor space signals, and what you want to do is to have access to the sources that are generating the brain activity, meaning going from sensor space to the source space. To do that, you have to use complex method of source reconstruction. There are actually two recognized clinical applications for MEG. These two applications are epilepsy, so the presurgical evaluation of patients with refractory focal epilepsy, and the presurgical evaluation of patients with brain lesions that are located close to eloquent cortices to perform presurgical functional mapping. So the interest of MEG for the presurgical evaluation of refractory epilepsy has been demonstrated by several studies. One of them has been performed by our group some years ago. It was a study performed on 70 consecutive patients, and as you can see, MEG did not record any epileptic activity in about 25% of the patients. The interesting aspect is that we included patients with presumed extratemporal lobe epilepsy, temporal lobe epilepsy, or patients with unclear localization epilepsy. What we found is that MEG changed the initial management of those patients in 21% of the patients, and it was mainly in patients with extratemporal lobe epilepsy or patients with unclear localization epilepsy. So MEG is not that interesting in patients with typical mesial temporal lobe epilepsy. The impact of MEG on the surgical management of patients with refractory focal epilepsy has been demonstrated by other studies, and it's always the same type of proportion, about 30 to 20% of the patients where MEG provide non-redundant or novel information about the epileptic disorder of the patient, and this helps you to better treat the epilepsy with surgical approach, for example, invasive monitoring. MEG will help you to identify epileptic activity that was not observed with EEG, to identify brain lesions in patients with presumed negative MRI, or to find also an unexpected irritative zone and helps you to add more intracranial electrodes that you did not plan to put initially. So I will show you one case just to illustrate you the power of MEG and its interest. I will show you more cases on Friday when I will have more time to develop the interest of MEG in clinical routine. So this is the story of a 30-year-old patient. He had an onset of epilepsy at 19 years old and a seizure semiology characterized by a nova, clonic movement of the right hemibody, post-seizure dysarthria, and he had daily seizure. He had several weeks of video EEG monitoring in different hospitals in Belgium with no interictal epileptic discharge that were observed in those different EEG. And the ictal EEG was not contributive because of high amplitude muscular artifact. On the MRI, he had a left frontal opercular lesion, presumably a focal cortical dysplasia, and the FDG PET showed a left frontal operculum hypometabolism. And because the EEG was not showing any epileptic activity. This patient was diagnosed as having non-epileptic seizure in another center in Belgium. When you put this patient in the MEG, this is what you get. So this is 10 seconds of MEG signal, and as you can see, there are almost continuous spike wave discharges over the left frontotemporal MEG sensors. This is the EEG corresponding to the MEG signal that I showed you, so it's simultaneous MEG-EEG recordings, and you can see that there is no spike that you can detect. So we have scanned this patient two times, one time with 64 EEG electrodes and one time with 128 EEG electrodes, and we did not find any interictal epileptic discharge on the EEG, while there was almost continuous spike wave discharge on the MEG. So my message to you is that MEG should be or must be considered in patients that in which you have a high suspicion of epilepsy but with normal EEG, because MEG can show you epileptic activity that EEG does not. The sources of the interictal epileptic discharge colocalized nicely with the MRI lesion, and we also had the chance to record two seizures during the first MEG session, and as you can see here, there is a small increase in gamma power amplitude in the few seconds before the onset of the seizure over the same MEG sensor that we recorded the interictal epileptic activity, and the sources of this gamma increase are located also at the level of the lesion. So based on this finding, we decided to perform stereoelectroencephalography with by implanting depth electrodes on different parts of the brain, including the lesion, and this was guided by the MEG findings. And this investigation confirmed that the lesion was involved in the epilepsy, and the patient had a tiny focal resection and is now seizure-free since 3 years. And here you can see the resection cavity on the CT scan, and you can see that the MEG dipole nicely colocalized with the brain area that has been removed in that patient. So you can say, okay, it's showing us his best case of epileptic patient where MEG has shown a great added value compared to EEG. Just want to show you this study where they investigated 43 patients with simultaneous EEG and MEG, and in 8 patients here, MEG was the only technique to identify interictal epileptic discharge, so it's about 20% of the patient. In one patient here, EEG was the only technique to detect epileptic activity, and in the other patient you can see that some spikes were only detected by MEG or by EEG, and that some of them were commonly detected by both techniques. So this really shows you that with EEG you have only access to one aspect of the epileptic disorder of your patient, and that with MEG you get a more complete picture of the epilepsy of your patient. The other indication of MEG is functional mapping. As you know, to perform functional mapping and to have a better idea of the anatomical relationship between a brain lesion and functionally eloquent cortices, you can use functional cerebral imaging. And worldwide, and presumably also in your countries, the main technique that is used is functional magnetic resonance imaging. As you may know, the fMRI provides you an indirect information about brain activity because it studies the variation in brain perfusion, so of the regional cerebral blood flow, which is linked to neuronal activity. And there are multiple physiological and complex mechanisms that link neuronal activity to changes in cerebral blood flow, and these neurovascular coupling can be altered by various brain disorders. So when you deal with a patient with a brain disorder, like a brain lesion, you are not sure that the neurovascular coupling will not be altered by the brain disorder. And if you use fMRI, you can have false positive or false negative results. And you don't have these caveats with MEG because it directly reflects the neural activity of the brain. So several studies have shown that MEG is very interesting to localize the central sulcus or the primary sensory motor cortex in patients with brain lesion, and that in some patients, MEG is superior to fMRI to localize the central sulcus, because either fMRI provides false results or you have multiple activation of non-primary cerebral areas that complicates the interpretation of the functional MRI results. For example, in this case, you can see that the main fMRI activity is located actually in the postcentral gyrus, while the MEG localizes properly in the central sulcus. And in epileptic patients, you can use in one single session MEG to do functional mapping and epilepsy mapping. Like in this epileptic patient with a tiny focal cortical dysplasia localized at the primary motor cortex hand area. And you can see that MEG localized nicely the primary motor cortex around the lesion and the primary somatosensory cortex just behind the central sulcus. And this is the localization of the interrectal epileptic discharge. So with one single technique, which is completely non-invasive, you can probably say that this patient is not a good candidate for epilepsy surgery because there is a high risk for motor function of the hand. MEG can also be used to determine language dominance and to replace the WADA test. And for example, in this study, they found a high degree of concordance between the WADA test and the results of the MEG for language lateralization. So this shows you that MEG can also be used for the functional mapping of your patient with brain lesion localized with functionally eloquent cortex, and can bring interesting information compared with fMRI. So in conclusion, MEG provides you direct information about neuronal activity. It has a high temporal and a good spatial resolution because it uses a high number of sensors and because magnetic fields are not altered or sensitive to changes in connectivity. It has a heightened sensitivity to fissural cortex activity, which explains you why MEG can see neuronal activity that EEG does not. And it provides you, in most of the neocortical area, a better signal-to-noise ratio for neocortical sources. In the context of epilepsy, MEG should be considered in the presurgical evaluation of patients with negative EEG and a high suspicion of epilepsy. I often hear epileptologists saying, why would you do an MEG in that patient because the EEG is normal? This is exactly the contrary. If the EEG is normal, you have to do an MEG if you suspect epilepsy in your patient. MEG is also interesting in patients with negative MRI because it will help you to localize subtle brain lesions. It's useful also in patients with discordant clinical finding, when you have a discordance between the semiology, the EEG, the MRI, and the FDG PET findings. And it's mainly interesting in patients with non-temporal lobe epilepsies. So MEG is a very nice tool to investigate pediatric epilepsy, because as you know, most of the epilepsies that occur in children are coming from outside the temporal lobe. MEG should also be considered for non-invasive functional mapping, and particularly in patients with atypical fMRI finding. And I will have the opportunity to develop much more than I can do now because of the limited time that I was given, all these aspects of MEG and the interesting aspects of MEG for the different clinical applications and for its use in research on Friday during two talks. So if you are interested, you are more than welcome to come on Friday morning. So I thank you for your attention.
Thank you.